Most of you have already met me. My name is Pia Pinger. I'm an assistant professor here in the Department of Economics. And I graduated from the University of Mannheim 3 years ago in 2013, which, in my impression, doesn't put me ahead a lot as compared to you. So I had the feeling, you know, I could have been sitting there maybe 1 or 2 years ago. So, and when I prepared this talk, I thought, well, what can I tell them that, you know, they would find useful? So I tried to put myself in your shoes, and I tried to prepare a talk that is structured along different types of methods or types of analyses that I think one could use to, if one wants to do research on critical periods in child development. And I think it also fits nicely with the talk we heard this morning. So in a way, it's a continuation of talking about methods. And I will spare out the structural methods, but I will talk about some of the other methods you can use. Okay, so this is the outline of my talk. So first I will provide some motivation about critical periods in child development and why I think research on this topic is really important, and why I want to encourage everyone to work on this, on these really important topics. Then I will talk about several studies, mostly my studies, stuff I worked on during my PhD thesis and afterwards. But the idea is that I want to structure it along the lines of how can you identify important critical periods, and how can you, which methods can you use to inspect whether which periods are important and how these critical periods map into long-term outcomes. So, first of all, I will talk about using contextual variation and instrumental variables. Then I will talk a little bit about matching on observables and unobservables, random effects and fixed effects and factor models. And then I will talk a bit about experiments. And then if we get to that, I want to conclude my talk by talking a little bit about mechanisms, because I think that's important too. So, during critical or sensitive periods in child development, investments may have an impact on the development of skills or education outcomes, but sometimes it can be hard to trace out what the underlying mechanisms are. And so that's some stuff I'm currently working on also that I want to tell you about. Okay, so what's the motivation for this? I think, well, first of all, we know that there are large returns to cognitive and non-cognitive skills and also health. And I think this graph is a graph we've seen from Flavio also. How does this work? So here, this is the 2006 paper by Hackman and co-authors, and on the axis here you have non-cognitive skills and cognitive skills, and on the y-axis you see log wages, and you can see that there's quite a substantial impact. If you translate the log wage into hourly wages, you can see that as you move someone from the lowest decile of cognitive and non-cognitive skills to the highest decile of cognitive and non-cognitive skills, you find that the wage almost doubles. Okay, so skills are important, and this is true. I really like this picture. This is actually true around the world. So this is a paper that came out in the European Economic Review last year. And what this shows is for a number of different countries, which you can see here, what's the return to numeracy skills, and numeracy skills here being a proxy for cognitive skills. And how you can interpret this is that what's the return to one standard deviation increase in cognitive skills in terms of hourly wages? And you can see that it's quite substantial in all kinds of countries all around the world. Yeah.
Is this before or after the Lexis?
That's a good question. I think it's before taxes. Yeah, I think it's before taxes. Yeah. I'm not sure. I think this is men only. Okay. So that's one thing. There are large returns to skills, and there's been a large literature on which types also of non-cognitive skills matter for labor market returns. And we know, for example, that conscientiousness is very important, locus of control is very important when it comes to wage returns. Openness to experience can be very important, and interestingly, openness to experience is especially important for individuals from lower socioeconomic status backgrounds. So if they are very open to experience, to getting themselves into new types of environments, that yields quite a large labor market return for them. So this is one thing. We know there are large returns to skills, but we also know that there are large returns to education, and especially that the return to education has been increasing over time. So this is a graph from a science paper by David Otter from 2014. It's for the US, and what you can see here, this is normalized, wages here are normalized to one in 1964, and then you can see how wages, relative wages, develop over time until 2012, and this is for women, and this is for men, and you can really see that returns to education are increasing, and that this is particularly so for the highest education category here, which is individuals that have more than a bachelor degree. And this is not only true for the US, but it's also true for Germany. Yeah, so this is a graph, I'm sorry for the German here. It's from the IAB, so the German Institute for, I don't know how to translate this, labor market and occupation or some things. And what you can see here is that this is age in years, and there you can see the gross yearly earnings for individuals with different education degrees. And you can also accumulate that for Germany. And what you see then, you know, this is like the lifetime earnings for individuals with different educational degrees. So it's quite costly not to get an education. The opportunity costs of not getting an education are high. Yeah.
So I have a question then, because with Flavio and Ian, we're seeing that apparently there has been a slow growth of the skilled labor supply, but also the returns to education are higher. So
I think that's one of the important puzzles why that is. And one explanation could be that individuals lack the skills once they enter higher education to complete the corresponding educational degrees. That's one explanation, but I think there's also a huge literature on the rising costs of college, especially in the US. The costs of higher education have been increasing. That's not so much the case in Germany. So, yeah, I think it's an important puzzle. Okay, so let me move back. I always have to do this in two computers. Okay, yeah, and who are the winners of this? Well, it's typically children from high socioeconomic status families. So there's also an intergenerational component to that and an equality of opportunity component that we might care about. So for example, here, this is again OECD data, so you have all kinds of countries here. And what you can see is the likelihood, the relative probability of scoring below level 2 in the PISA test. So below level 2, I think it ranges from 1 to 7 or so, and scoring below level 2 is performing quite poorly. And it's the relative probability of performing poorly in the PISA test for children from low socioeconomic status backgrounds versus high socioeconomic status backgrounds, and this is by parental education. Yeah, so you can see that the probability of performing poorly in those tests is quite a bit higher for children from low socioeconomic status backgrounds.
And that means the probability is twice as high?
Yes, exactly. So the probability on average is twice as high to do poorly on the PISA test for low socioeconomic status children than for high socioeconomic status children. And you find Germany here. So you can see that Germany is one of the countries that is doing relatively worse in this kind of comparison. Okay, so now I can move like that. Yeah, we can also, this is data from the Bonn intervention panel, and I just thought I just graph how skills are the distribution of skills for children from high and low socioeconomic status backgrounds, and I will get back to this later, how high and low socioeconomic status is defined. So you can see here that this is at the age of 8, just about children from low socioeconomic status backgrounds have lower IQ scores. They tend to do worse in terms of internalizing. So this is depression and behavioral problems or problems with other children. So they tend to show more internalizing behavior. They also tend to show more externalizing behavior. So this is problem behavior and being hyperactive, having problems to concentrate and stuff like that. Okay, and we also observe quite a high persistence in all kinds of countries. So the probability of getting an education that's below upper secondary is substantially higher for individuals that come from lower socioeconomic status backgrounds, so whose parents also have below upper secondary education, than for children whose parents have higher education. And this is true for almost all countries. Well, why would we care as economists? Aside from this, I think in itself being interested, I think economists here come in because as economists, we care about the allocation of scarce resources. And we want to invest resources, let's say tax money, for example, in a way that the return to this type of investment is highest. And as a researcher, I think then one of our goals could be to find out, well, what are important investment periods? Yeah? What are so-called critical periods for human capital formation? So in terms of when are investments in which periods are the returns to investments highest in terms of long-term, mostly economic outcomes. And then from this we would derive policy recommendations such that policy could be targeted accordingly. And I think when we reason for this, there are two main reasons. So there's an efficiency reason, yeah? So we, as economists, we're interested in using the lowest amount of resources to create the greatest amount of outputs. But then there's also this equality of opportunity reasoning behind, which is that as a society, we may want to remove influences or factors over which individuals have no control, such as the accident of birth. Yes?
So let me propose that a different reason.
Sure.
And that is that we have certain notions of what individuals deserve. And so we wouldn't use the no control argument to say that people who have more ability or more productive autonomy have higher.
Right, that's true. That's actually.
And nor would we say that the fact that market price, that the skill bias technical change the market productivity of skill, which is beyond any basic is something we necessarily mitigate. So I really want to put on the table, I think that within economics, discussions of quality of opportunity are focused too much on responsibility and not enough on what I think actually motivates us, because we have notions of certain things we think ought to be rewarded, and we want to mitigate the other ones.
And it's not so clear what these are, right? I mean, that was part of Bertie's work that he presented here, that people have different notions of what should be rewarded. So should we reward someone who's very smart, or is born with great genes that, make him or her, right?
Yeah, I don't want to create a digression, but I would say we can have a debate on the nature of the compensation.
Right.
Nobody in this room could make a serious argument that two people that are equally productive do exactly the same job, you would pay one of them 10% less because that person's female or African American.
That's true. Yeah, yeah, that's for sure. So I think that's what we can probably all agree on. Yeah. Okay, so what's a critical period? A critical period is a maturational stage at which investments are particularly fruitful and also vital. But it also means that if an individual does not receive a certain stimulus during that period, it may be difficult or ultimately even, you know, less successful or impossible to develop some functions later in life. No? So remediation can be costly or even impossible. And suboptimal conditions, in a sense of underinvestments, can have very long-run implications, resulting in lower human capital. And sometimes people make a distinction between a critical period and a sensitive period. And a sensitive period here would be mostly a more extended period, after which learning or investment is still possible. So that's a period where it's particularly fruitful to invest it's particularly fruitful to invest, but it's still, remediation is still possible afterwards. Yeah, so if there's underinvestment during a sensitive period, it's not necessarily the case that we observe, let's say, a dip in long-term labor market performance, because it could be that there's some other process that makes up for that later in time. Okay, so I think I already said that. What are critical periods? I think the more narrow definition, or the more classical definition, is that a critical period is some kind of biological period during which certain skills or character traits or so preferences develop. And I found this graph from this Council for Early Child Development. I think that's located at Harvard, and it's based on several studies. And what you can see here is that, well, stuff we saw before during the summer school, that especially for the development of cognitive and non-cognitive skills, it's really the early years that matter a lot. Yeah, so then here, these are graphs of sensitivity that are based on many different studies. I think there's a second type of critical period, and that's a critical period in decision making. And those critical periods very much depend on the social context. So think of the time when in the US students take their SATs. If you badly screw up your SAT, I mean, you can retake it, I know that, but it's gonna have a really bad long-term impact on your educational outcomes, because it determines which type of college you can go to. In Germany, if something really bad happens just before the time tracking happens, after grade 4 in Germany, children are tracked into different school tracks. If something really bad happens then, for example, the father becomes unemployed, or, I don't know, the parents divorce, that can have really long-term impacts on the educational career of a child. So I think there's a second type, which I now also call critical period, that we should keep in mind, and that's really very much depends on the social and institutional context. So that can be very different for different countries. So for example, here, this is a picture of gross wages, annual wages for individuals that were tracked onto the three different types of tracks in Germany. So this is for individuals that were in the highest track, this is for individuals that were in the middle track, and this is for individuals who were in the lowest track. This is not causal or anything, but I'm just saying that, you know, if you do if you happen to do badly at important educational transitions, that can have very long-term effects in terms of labor market outcomes, possibly. Okay, and then I think, if there is underinvestment during critical periods, that can then possibly have long-term effects both within and maybe also across generations. So I think this is one thing I want to talk about, that long-term effects across generations. I think this is a very interesting research area that's flourishing quite a bit, but that's also very much emerging. You know, what are the very, very long-term implications of some kind of policy, let's say, that improves education outcomes, even on the next generation and on the generations thereafter? And there's now much more data available that we can use to study these questions. Okay, so now let's say you're a PhD student, you're interested in this topic. What do you need? Well, first of all, I think you need data. It would be good to have data on parental or maybe school investments. You would want to have some kind of variation in investments, so that you can study differences between individuals that have received different types of investments at different ages. And you would also want to have some outcomes for the children you're studying. Ideally, some kind of labor market outcomes. And that can be a problem, for example, if you're dealing with randomized controlled trials or so, that there are very few studies where we actually have labor market outcomes. And I think Horatio was talking about that the Jamaican study is one of the very few ones where labor market outcomes are available. Then you need some kind of model or hypothesis. And I think for this first type of critical periods, the biological critical periods, the technology of skill formation is just great. It's what everybody has in mind. It's really a great framework for people of how to think about skill development over time. So that was a really important contribution. I think what's lacking in terms of there's much less of a theoretical framework existing for example, educational transitions over time, or for other kinds of, let's say, the impact of mentoring programs for students. So I think there's a lot of other types of studies around to which the technology of skill formation does not apply, and they're less good or renowned theoretical framework in which people think. And then you need an identification strategy, right? So we need some kind of strategy and statistical method that allows us to make a causal statement about childhood investments or the lack thereof at different ages on long-term outcomes. Okay, which brings me to the next topic, which is different types of identification strategies. So, and I will start out with contextual variation and instrumental variables. Okay, so, before I do that, I want to just review a little bit the fundamental problem of identification that we're facing here. Just very briefly. I hope I don't bore you. Okay, so if we're interested in the causal effect of underinvestment during age period T, then we could, to make it like super, super simple, we could think about investment in terms of a binary variable. So a variable that only takes on values 0 and 1, where 0 is low investment and 1 is high investment. And then the question we would be interested in is what would have happened to an individual who has received very little investments, so is D equals 0, if that individual had received more. So we can think of that problem in terms of potential outcomes. Yeah. So there are two outcomes for every individual. Let's say wages or educational performance with high investments and educational performance with low investments. But the problem is that we only observe one of them, right? That's just this fundamental problem that we'd never observe the same individual in two universes. So we either only observe the guy if he goes that way, or if the parents chose to send that child that way, or if the parents chose to send that child that way. Which is very difficult, which can be very difficult, because in order to make causal statements, we somehow have to make people comparable. Or we have to compare individuals that are similar in terms of their characteristics. So if we're interested in the effect of a certain investment, D, on an outcome such as wages, Y, then we face this problem that there are many, many, many other things going on in the household that affect both the amount of investment that parents provide or that maybe schools provide and the outcome at the same time. Yeah, so if you'd specify like a linear equation model here for the outcome Y, that is linear in the treatment, at the investment, and some kind of error terms, then the problem would be that there's stuff here in that U that's correlated both with the D and with the Y, which would bias our causal, the coefficient rho here, which would represent the causal effect of investment on outcomes. Yeah, so there's, in this type of literature, there's a huge identification problem that endogeneity is almost everywhere. It's very hard to find situations where we can really talk about, you know, ceteris paribus changes in investments. Yeah, so keeping everything else constant, what would happen if we just increased investments by a little bit? Experiments are great, but they can be difficult to identify critical and sensitive periods because, for example, it takes a very long time to observe labor market outcomes. I don't know, it can be very costly. For a PhD student, it can be almost prohibitively costly to run an RCT, both in terms of time and money. Also, I think most types of experiments or RCTs, or many of them, especially when it comes to the early years, they are either done in developing countries or on disadvantaged populations in the developed world. Why is that? Because you cannot take away resources from people, right? It's almost impossible to tell parents, okay, you're now completely undernourishing your child, you're neglecting your child for the next year, because they're not going to comply, and it's probably unethical to do that. So what people then do, for example, you saw that with Horatio's talk, they go, if they're interested, for example, in the causal effect of nutrition on child development, you would go to a developing country where the level of nutrition is very high, where there are many stunted children, such that you could just, you know, provide a benefit to one randomly assigned group and not, you know, not to another group. Okay, and then there's another problem that I want to talk about a little bit, is that the other strategy you could do is you wait until people are adults and then you retrospectively ask them about the investments they got during childhood. But then the problem is they are not going to remember that very well, especially when you want to investigate the impact of investments before, let's say, the age of 4 or 5. People hardly remember anything before the age of 4, so they're not going to remember whether their parents treated them well or whether they got a lot of food to eat and things like that. Okay. I think one strategy that people use is that they use some kind of contextual variation. So they use variation either due to historical incidences or maybe variation in macroeconomic conditions or policy changes that somehow exogenously provided variation to the environment in which the child grew up. The advantage being that very often if we do that, we observe very long-term outcomes for these individuals. Yeah. So, for example, there's a series of papers that use the Dutch hunger winter as an exogenous variation. So during the Second World War, there was a time when Germany had occupied the west of the Netherlands, so the region Utrecht, and then there are two other regions called, I think, South Holland and North Holland. And the Allied, or the exile government, they had told their people in the occupied parts of the Netherlands to do a railroad strike, yeah, to retaliate on the Germans. But the Germans didn't at all like that. So what they did, they basically isolated that part of the Netherlands from all kinds of imports, and a really, really bad famine happened, which is really bad. But researchers that use it now, this type of variation allows them to compare children that were both growing up in the Netherlands but in just different parts of the countries, and one children that grew up on that part of the country where the famine happened can be compared with children that grew up just across the border of occupation, and that otherwise grew up under very similar conditions. There are also various policy changes that people exploit, such as the introduction of food stamps. There's one JPE paper I read about an alcohol policy in Sweden that impacted how much mothers drank during pregnancy, and then looks at long-term outcomes. Okay, and I think there are some advantages to using contextual variation and some disadvantages, and there are more than what I just wrote down here. I think the advantages that when to using contextual variation, it gives some kind of quasi-experimental exogenous change in investment, possibly a very large variation in inputs even. You know, if you use things like wars or bad famines or influenza periods, then sometimes the variation in inputs can actually be quite strong. And this variation in inputs can be linked to long-term outcomes. Yeah, and it, so this way, it allows us, this contextual variation to allow us to study the impact of investments or lack thereof, both within and across generations, because we can have very long-term follow-ups. Disadvantages are, first one being, you kind of have to take whatever is there, right? So people, they just look, what kind of contextual variation is there? What can I use? Can I argue that it's possibly exogenous? So it's a little bit like starting from the end. You know, people sometimes have this tendency to select questions based on what kind of variation there is, instead of starting from the research question and then looking or collecting the appropriate data. Often also, measures of compliance are absent, and I will talk a little bit about that. So often we know whether someone lived or experienced the first 4 years of life in a region where there was a really bad recession, but we don't actually know whether that changed the monetary investments that the parents did into the child. Yeah, so then we know a little bit about the context that individuals were living up, but were growing up in, but we don't really know whether they were actually affected by that context. And that can be important if we're interested in the causal effects of investments. And then there's another problem that's discussed much in this literature, and that's selective fertility and selective mortality, or selective attrition. So it can be that if we compare individuals that were growing up during very bad times, that so for example, individuals that experienced a famine when they were really, really small, that they don't actually live up to age 60, and then we don't observe them, selectively don't observe them in our data later on. Can also be that if like macroeconomic conditions are really bad, it induces women not to have children at all during such a period, and that might be very selective. So who nevertheless has children and who doesn't? Okay, so the idea is that then this exogenous macroeconomic whatever variation policy change provides an instrument, so some kind of exogenous variation which shifts parental investments or investments at home or school investments or whatever, allowing us to trace out the effects of that investment net off all of the other confounders that are around. And then there are two assumptions, that from econometrics, that we need the instrument to be plausibly exogenous, and we need it to be relevant. So we need it to be a strong shifter here.
Yeah? If I make one observation, you mentioned something that's important, which is that these quasi-experiments involve large variation. Mm-hmm. And often when we think about identification, we tend to think about it as distinct from the precision of estimates. And another way to think about non-identification is the limit of imprecise estimates. So I think what you brought up was very important in that respect. There is another side to it, which is the behaviors may be qualitatively different with large versus small changes. So on the case of the famine in that part of the Netherlands, the conventional interpretation has been that in utero pregnancies, there were genetic markers were shifted. Mm-hmm. And so the differences in adult outcomes are because of epigenetic factors. There is another possibility, which is that if somebody experiences a famine while pregnant, they raise their kids differently.
Absolutely.
And so I think it's useful to keep in mind that there's always assumptions involved even in these experiments.
Yeah. No, that's totally true. And also it's important when we think about the policy implications we want to derive from these things. I mean, if you use a famine as an exogenous shifter here that may change investments, then if there are heterogeneous treatment effects, so if the effect of that change in investments is heterogeneous, because then we would have to think also which type of the population was shifted into a different state by that instrument, and which types of investments have changed, and is that at all the policy parameter we're interested in ultimately? Yeah? So I mean, it's clear we all want to avoid famines, right? That's not the right. I mean, that's not really the policy anyone would care about, I guess. Okay, so we need that the instrument is exogenous and that it's relevant. And then usually what people have in their data is either variation across time. Yeah, so a policy was introduced maybe suddenly in one particular year or month, so that we can compare cohorts, let's say, that were born before the introduction of the policy and after the introduction of the policy. But we have to keep in mind that there might be other cohort effects going on. It might be that there is some kind of variation across space, such as with my famine example before. So one region is affected and another region is not. And that allows us then to make comparison of individuals in different locations. And we would have to argue that these individuals are otherwise very similar. Sometimes there is variation across cutoffs, such as school grades or some kind of income cutoffs or so. So then usually what people do is they compare individuals that are very close to the cutoff, assuming that individuals are very similar that are very close to the cutoff. And sometimes we're really lucky and we get some kind of a lottery. So for example, this, I think a lot of the papers that evaluate the effectiveness of charter schools, they're lucky enough to be able to use some kind of lottery into who gets into these schools or not. And this is also something one can use when one is designing an RCT, for example, that there's some kind of either a waitlist design or some other kind of design where access to a good treatment is restricted and some people get in by chance and others don't. And then there are three, if we do some kind of IV analysis, there are three relationships that we might care about. First of all, it's the so-called structural equation or the outcome equation. So this rho here continues to be the causal parameter we care about. Yeah? This is the parameter we want to identify. And this here is not like a usual IID or like a regression residual or so, but it's more of some kind of a structural error term. And then we have a first stage, which is the effect of the instrument on the treatment. Yeah? So that's like a first causal relationship we may care about. And then there's another type of causal relationship we may care about, and that is the impact of the instrument on the outcome. So this is what we call the reduced form. And sometimes, or this can be of interest in its own right, if you want to evaluate the overall impact, the macroeconomic impact of a policy, you might also actually want to care about that. So if you want to know how the expansion of increase of the compulsory schooling age affects whatever population health, then one might be interested in the impact of that the introduction of that policy had on aggregate health in the population without actually caring how many individuals were affected. Yeah? So not about the causal effect at the individual level, but about the aggregate effect. These three equations here, they are related to each other. Yeah? So for example, what we can do is we can use our structural equation and we can plug in the first stage here. And, you know, summarize this a little bit. And what you can see then is that the reduced form coefficients that have like a sub 2 here, that they are related to the first stage coefficients. And what's important here is that, and that I think people have to keep it or should keep in mind when they look at studies that use some kind of contextual variation, is that the causal effect we may care about at the individual level, yeah, is the ratio of these two coefficients, namely the effect of the reduced form, yeah, so the impact of the instrument on the outcome weighted by the rate of compliance. And that makes sense, right? So if this is really small, yeah, so if we don't observe a large impact of a policy change on the population outcome, then that might be the case because very few individuals actually complied, so very few individuals were actually shifted by the contextual variation in terms of investments. And this is also what gives us the relationship between the, let's say, two-stage D-squares estimator with the Wald estimator, is that really the causal effect we're interested in is the overall effect or the expected value of the outcome for individuals that experienced a certain exogenous variation versus the average outcome or expected value of individuals that did not experience that, and that's then weighted by the probability to be actually affected by the contextual variation here. Okay, so this is a measure of compliance where individuals actually affected that lived in a certain period of time where some kind of policy change took place, or where a famine took place, or where a big recession took place. And one problem is that we often have in the data that is that this is not actually observed, or that individuals may not remember that when they for very young ages. So I want to just show you some results from a paper I did during my PhD, where we studied the causal effect of a nutritional shortage in infancy on adult health, using a famine as an instrument, but then also having some information about compliance, so retrospective information about whether individuals remember that they actually suffered from hunger when they were children, which allows us to do this scaling here. Yeah, so we don't only know about the outcomes of individuals that lived during a famine when small versus not, but we also know something about compliance. Yeah, so in that paper, the instrumental variable strategy we use is that we have an instrument, which is a famine due to a trade blockade related to World War II in three countries. Then the treatment would be a nutritional shortage, and the outcome we're focusing on in that paper is adult height. And what we do is we have in the data, we have an estimate of compliance. So people are retrospectively asked whether they were affected by the famine or whether they suffered from hunger. And then I think the most interesting contribution of the paper is that we think a little bit about how can we deal in that context with a situation of imperfect recall. So if people selectively remember their childhood, depending on how old they were when that famine happened. Okay, so we use SHARE data, which is the Survey of Health, Aging, and Retirement in Europe. It's people 50 plus. And yeah, so we mainly use the third wave, where people are asked retrospectively about the course of their life. And one question that's in there is whether they remember the following question. Looking back at your life, was there a distinct period during which you suffered from hunger? So this is our measure of, that's the treatment, or from this we can also derive this measure of compliance, depending on whether someone lived during the famine, how much more likely are they to report that during that time they actually suffered from a period of hunger. And the instrument we use is famines in three countries, all related to this to World War II. So it's first this west of the Netherlands, which I already told you about, and then there was a famine related to an embargo by the Allied forces in Greece, and then a little bit less severe famine in Germany after the Second World War. Okay, so what you can see here is the probability to report a period of severe hunger by calendar year. And what you can see here is that matches with the historical evidence we have, namely, yeah, that people are much more likely to report that period during the time that we actually know from historical sources that the famine happened. This is something we would expect. And then what we do, we construct a binary treatment variable from the data, and we construct a binary instrumental variable. So 0-1 variables for whether someone reported hunger first during age 6 to 16. So this is a time where people should more or less remember their childhood, and then also whether they experienced a famine during that time. And this is a graph which basically shows that we have to align several types of information, namely, when were these people, or what's the calendar year, how old were people at that time, so the lines here, these are different cohorts, and then we want to know whether individuals report that they suffered from hunger depending on how old they were and depending on the calendar year. Yeah, so this would be someone who would comply to the instrument, because that person reports that he or she's actually suffered during that period, during the age window we care about. And then we do like a non-parametric walled estimator, where we integrate over the other covariates we're controlling for. And in our case, it's actually relatively simple. These are not integrals, but sums, because this is just just discrete variables. And we also do some kind of two-stage least squares analysis. Okay, so then I don't want to focus that much on the results. I just want to tell you we don't really find that much. If there was a nutritional shock if individuals experienced it between the age of 6 to 16, when we look at their body height when they're adults, yeah, which is basically just a proxy for health, but it's also a good proxy of how much nutritional intake you got when you were really small. Yeah. Actually, body height is 80% genes, but so for individuals who grew up under good nutritional conditions, your body height is not related to your parental investments. But it turns out that if children get too little food when they're really small, that can be measured by body height. Okay, and then so this was age 6 to 16, yeah, so we only looked at individuals that were ages 6 to 16 during the famine, and we looked at possible compliance. What's now for what about younger children? Yeah, so for children that were 0 to 4 or even in utero, yeah, so we're for sure going to get some kind of selective recall bias if the famine happened very early in childhood, yeah, because people are just not going to remember well. And at the extreme, if they were in utero, they won't even think that the question really applies to them. And you can see that here, yeah, so the probability to report, yeah, having suffered from hunger during childhood increases dramatically with the age at which the age that children had when they experienced the different famines. And what we do then to solve that problem is that we replace this part of the Wald estimator, yeah, so this we get an estimate of compliance from the older sample, which we call the childhood sample. Yeah? So we compute the probability to actually report hunger for individuals that lived during the famine during a certain age period versus not, conditional on some covariates. And we just plug that in here into the Wald estimator, where all of the other information in the Wald estimator comes from the infancy sample. And another thing we do is a more parametric method, which is two samples, two-stage least squares, and there's also a literature on that, combining information from different samples. Okay, and there we find a reduced form effect for this age group, especially for men, of about 0.68 centimeters. And then what's interesting, I think, is, well, that if you think about the causal effect, you have to scale it with this measure of compliance, and you get it then a causal effect of about two centimeters in body height. Yeah, so the treatment effects we find are then usually 3 to 8 times higher than the reduced form estimates, which is clear because it's this scaling that takes place. Yeah, so this basically says something about the rate of compliance. Okay, briefly, yeah?
Can I just ask one question related to what Azadura said just earlier? If you do this replacement of the compliance measure, that assumes that the impact of living in a hunger region is the same regardless which age you are.
Right. Now,
if the
yeah.
parents,
it's
wrong, but that if there is a behavioral response by parents which differs by the age of the child, then this is not valid.
This is not valid. That's totally right. So, for example, it could be that famines take food away from older children in their family and give it to the younger ones.
That's what I was thinking.
That's very probably, and we discussed it a little bit in the paper. Also, breastfeeding is an issue, right? So very young children might be breastfed, and then, yeah, we don't really know. Yeah. Okay. Another thing I have been working on is, do we see some kind of effects of a shock during a critical period, even on the next generation? And I think this, I don't know if you know this intergenerational literature, yeah, this intergenerational mobility literature, there's, I think it's very exciting. There's lots of things going on. A lot of it is more correlational. Yeah? So people discuss what's the elasticity between fathers, or the so the elasticity of fathers' wages with respect to sons' wages. But there's more and more studies now emerging that look at actually a lot of different generations, and that are also more interested, let's say, in the causal impact of some kind of shock or situational circumstance, even across generations. Yeah? So the question here is, we know that the persistence in social status is pretty high. Yeah? We also know that there is quite some persistence in health. And then the question here would be, how much of that is causal? Phil Oriopoulos, for example, he has many papers where he studies the impact of a causal change in education among the parent generation, using variation in compulsory schooling laws, and then studying what's the impact of a causal change in education of the parent generation on child outcomes. Yeah. For health, there's much less out there. There is a famous series of papers. There are many questions. I think it's a very, very, very difficult field to work in as well, because it's very difficult to separate biological mechanisms from social mechanisms. Usually, if you study several generations, there's so much stuff going on related to history. It's very hard to make anything like a causal statement there. So I think it's an emerging but probably a difficult field of research. There's one series of paper that I thought I'd tell you about, because it's so much discussed in the epidemiological literature. And it's about, are there biological effects of certain environmental changes that last even across generations? And what I think is interesting, or what I found quite eye-opening, was that in the epidemiological literature, they make a big difference between so-called intergenerational effects and transgenerational effects. So if you ever get in touch with that literature, it took me a while to figure that out. An intergenerational effect can be an effect that lasts across generations, and now I'm talking about biological effects, but it's effects that are potentially direct. For example, think about a mother, and she has a baby, she's pregnant. Yeah, so there's a baby in utero. Now something bad happens to the mother, such as the Dutch famine, then that affects the mother, it affects the baby, but it also affects the baby's germ cells. Yeah, so potentially three generations are affected here at the same time. And then there are so-called transgenerational effects, and this is effects on individuals that are potentially not pregnant. And and then you can study shocks to these individuals, and then later, for example, they may have children, and then you can look at the outcomes of their descendants. Yeah, why am I telling you this? Because especially in this literature or discussion of epigenetic effects, there is this famous over colleague study studying so-called transgenerational effects. So what they are saying in a series of papers is that a shock to male individuals during the ages 9 to 12 has an effect on the sperm, so on the germ cells, and that potentially has an effect on subsequent generations. And they back it up with some studies on mice. Yeah, so you can easily do these kind of epigenetic or transgenerational effect studies using mice, right? So you starve one generation, or you stress one generation, and then you look how the subsequent generations are doing. And you can even use mice that have exactly the same genome. Yeah, so that's all possible. So any changes that you would observe are epigenetic. And by the way, what does epigenetic mean? So epigenetic here means that everybody has the genome, and the genome tells the cells how the cells should look like. Yeah, so it's in a way the plan of how the body should make the cells. And then epigenetics means that there's certain methylation patterns on the genome such that the proteins which read the DNA, they get different information depending on how these methylation patterns are on the genome and how the genome is wrapped around in so-called histones. So this is providing me information on how the cells should be built, not because there are differences in DNA, but because there are differences in these methylation patterns on the DNA. Yeah, so there's this famous study, at least in the biological and epidemiological literature, where they argue, well, there's a critical period for males age 9 to 12, if something really bad happens in nutritional shock, for example, that affects the descendants of male individuals, so it probably changes the epigenetic structure on the male sperm, and we can observe adaptive responses in subsequent generations. So if like a biological shock happens to the first generation, we generally see improvements or better outcomes in subsequent generations. And when I did my PhD, I thought this is kind of fascinating, and I tried to replicate it using German data. And surprisingly, we did actually find some adaptive response, but it was mostly in mental health. And it's not so sure. The sample we used was relatively small. It seems that the biological mechanisms are implausible because we know a little bit in our data about which generations live together, whether grandchildren know their grandparents. We know the education of the different generations. So we did find some adaptive responses. And then I worked on other replication studies related to that. So right now I did a paper with epidemiologists using Norwegian data, where we used, or we validated actually another paper with a very similar argument, and we didn't really find any effects. Right now I'm also working on data using 4 generations of Swedish individuals, and we don't really find the same patterns in the data, but maybe it's a little bit too early to tell. One of these papers, so these authors here have this series of papers where they say, well, age 9 to 12 is really important critical period for males, and it affects how their descendants the health of their descendants. They have another series of papers where they argue age 9 to 12 is really important for males. And they don't look at a nutritional shock, but they say that if males start smoking super early, that can have adaptive responses in the children. And they argue that if males start smoking very early, their descendants are more likely to be obese. And that was a huge discussion among epidemiologists, because if that was true, it would mean that we have an explanation for why the so-called smoking epidemic in the US was followed by the obesity epidemic. So for a long time, there were lots of people smoking, especially in the US, and now we observe a lot of obese people in the US, and they were, in a way, providing a rationale for that. But as said, we tried to replicate that in Norwegian data, and we don't find any of that. So I think I just wanted to tell you, I think this is just interesting research there being done by epidemiologists related to biological adaptive responses across generations. Exactly. I just wanted to tell you a little bit about that. Okay, so now we talked about the fundamental problem of identification, and we also talked about different ways to use contextual variation and instrumental variables. And the following now, I want to talk to you a little bit about matching strategies, but only very brief, and then about an experiment or RCT. Okay, so another way to solve this endogeneity problem, remember, it is very likely that we have some kind of correlation between stuff that's here in the U, in the unobservables, and the treatment, the investment treatment we care about, D. And I think we can use, or one other strategy would be to make people comparable by just controlling for lots of observable things, yeah, lots of regressors that are potentially omitted in this relationship here, such that in the end, such that we somehow find some statistical twins, so we find individuals that are the same, in terms of all kinds of dimensions we may care about that also correlate with investments and outcomes, and that only differ in terms of the parental investments or the treatment effect here. So either we can just control on lots of stuff, doing some kind of OLS regression or propensity score matching. And I don't want to talk about that very much. I think it's very hard to publish a paper. I mean, sometimes it's possible, but yeah. And you also know, I mean, the simplest way to do that would be, you run some kind of OLS regression and you just put in lots and lots and lots of observable regressors here. Another strategy would be to model the unobserved heterogeneity. And one way to do that would be to use some kind of random effects model or a factor model, as we have already seen. Yeah. So in a way, you model the part of the unobservables that you think may be important here and that may cause some of the endogeneity problem. Or you may try to get rid of the unobserved heterogeneity in some kind of other way, such as using fixed effects. And I want to show you an example of that as well. Maybe, given that I only have 20 minutes left, I would skip over the factor model stuff, because you've already seen that in the other lectures. Yeah. So the idea here is you have multiple measurements on some kind of underlying trait that could be an investment. It could also be some kind of skills, and you use that in a more, let's say, structural econometric kind of way to model the part of the unobserved heterogeneity, some part of the unobserved heterogeneity here. And then making some distributional and orthogonality assumptions, independence assumptions. We can do that more flexible, but I think Flavio told you also about the ratio of the covariances, although his model is much more complicated than anything I have ever estimated. And then we can, and then you can write down the likelihood and you can estimate it either using frequentist method or Bayesian methods. You can also do some kind of two-step approach where you first estimate the factors using the measurement system, and then you, in a second step, you plug those factors into your structural equation here to, in a way, match individuals on their unobservables. And this also then allows you to take care of measurement error at the same time in variables such as investments, for which we may have a lot of different imperfect measurements, or skills, such as if you think of an IQ test, you have lots of imperfect measurements on the underlying IQ. What's nice about this is that you can use it to simulate very well. Another way to do this is that you would somehow model this part of the unobserved heterogeneity not in a random effects kind of way, yeah? Because in a static setting, the factor model really is not that much different from a random effects model where you just make a particular assumption on the structure of the random effect. But you could also assume that that's a fixed effect. One way to do that would be, for example, that you observe families with several siblings and that you would say, well, any of the unobservables are family specific. So any of this stuff that correlates both with the treatment and with the output, with the outcome variable, that potentially biases the causal, the coefficient that reflects the causal effect I'm interested in, is really family specific. And then what you could do is, if siblings have received different types of investments, you could run a model that includes some kind of fixed effect and just compare the outcomes of different siblings. And I think there's a really nice example, I kind of like that paper. So I was also an RA on that, but when I was a PhD student. So there's a paper by Vandenberg and co-authors. And what they study critical periods during childhood and adolescence. And what the idea they use is that they compare siblings who came to Sweden at different points in time. Yeah? And you can imagine, we're talking here about children that come from really very, very poor countries. And you can imagine that it might make a difference whether a child comes when it's like 3 or 4 months old versus when it's 15 years old. Yeah? So the critical time when investments matter, yeah, so investments may be very different when a child is in Sweden versus when that child is in a very poor African country. So by just using the variation of children coming into Sweden at different points in time, that may allow us to learn something about critical periods. And we can take care, or they take care, of the endogeneity here by introducing a fixed effect into the model, which is a family-specific fixed effect, which just soaks up anything in the model that otherwise would lead to, you know, the bias and the confounding. Yeah, so the family fixed effect wipes out shocks that are common to both siblings within the family. And they do that, and they have these neat graphs, which basically tells you how certain outcomes, so for example, this is cognitive tests, how they compare for children who came to Sweden at later points in time. So this is the age at migration, versus kids that come right, I think, when the mother is still pregnant or right at birth, so at age zero. So this allows you to say something about critical periods, because we can see, for example, that when children come from a developed country after the age of eight, that has very lasting impacts on how they perform in standardized cognitive tests when they're older. Okay, so last but not least, what you could do, yeah?
Just a comment on that graph. Seven is also the sort of school starting age in Sweden in general.
Yeah, I think that's one of the problems, or maybe not problems, in that paper. They generally, they look at lots of different outcomes. The Swedish data, they're just, I mean, you know, they're just great. So they have all immigrants from poor countries and all the children, and they have the all kinds of test scores and measurements from the military draft data. So for a long time, not anymore, but for a long time in Sweden, all men were drafted at the age of 17 or 18. So almost for the entire male population, you have tests that were done with them when they were during the draft. And yeah, so they used all kinds of these. I just took two examples. And for almost all outcomes, they find that this is a very important period. So from age 7 to age 9, but this coincides with the time when children go to school. So it could just be that if children come, you know, that there's a confounding or a mixing up or a joint effect of like a biological critical period with a social, you know, what I call social critical period before. And it's just really hard for children to do well in school when they just arrive in a country when they're already in third grade.
Yeah, it might be difficult to start in a new class where everyone already knows each other and the social
media. Exactly, you don't know the language.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
What I also think interesting here is this suggests that there is no large effect of growing up in a poor country until the age of around six or so, which could suggest that like it's mostly not family investments, but like the educational system.
Yeah, yeah. So in that sense, you know, the variation they use here, that's actually a really good point. The variation they use here is clearly outside family variation, right? In fact, I mean, you could think that the investments are quite similar within family for different siblings. And this is something you basically take out by taking out the fixed effect.
But I think it also maybe has like a negative implication, meaning that when parents arrive in a richer country and they have fewer constraints, it doesn't really mean that they are investing more. It's more the education. At least the draft suggests this.
Yeah. Yeah.
That totally. Like there are more family invested.
Yeah. No, could be totally. Yeah. Very. Yeah. Sympathetic there. Okay, so then let me get to the last part, which is using experiments. And during the last year, it's the first time I was lucky enough to join a team of people working with truly experimental data. So there is this Bond intervention panel here, and now the fourth wave is being collected, or is this a fifth? The fifth wave is being collected already. And so I'm lucky enough now to join the team, at least for some, looking at some questions. And we started a first project. And in that project, what we do is we look at the effect of a mentoring program, which is basically this what this Bond intervention panel is about. Children got a mentor during grade 2 or 3, and now we have first this education outcomes, so we can look at the effect of such a mentoring program on education outcomes. And I think that has a very nice angle to that, especially in the German context, where there's a lot of inequality of opportunity for low socioeconomic status, children from low socioeconomic status backgrounds. I think there is a rising literature also in behavioral economics of education, and I recommend a paper by Lavecchia and Oriopoulos and one more co-author. They have a very nice summary of educational interventions, mentoring interventions, mostly during these or just before these critical decision periods, and the effects of that. And I think it's an emerging and it's a rising literature which deals with some of the puzzles someone mentioned before, that returns to education are rising, but we don't see that many more individuals getting an education, which is a puzzle. And if you ask people, actually I have prepared, if you ask people for why they didn't get more education, yeah, you can just ask them later on, so why didn't you get more education? It's interesting that the reasons, what they say about why they didn't get more education, is usually not the reasons that economists have traditionally studied. So economists usually care about credit constraints or maybe something like early pregnancies or some kind of other more financial constraints. But this is a results from a questionnaire that asks individuals why they stopped school. And a lot of the responses are more like, I didn't see the point of going on, or I didn't like it that much, I just wanted to work. And things such as I couldn't afford to go on, they rank very low in terms of the reasons that people bring forward. But of course, this is just European countries, so it might be very different in the US. Nevertheless, I think this, and also the fact that many individuals regret having quit school too early. So if you ask high school dropouts later on, more than half of them will say that they regret having left school so early on, I think leads to a rising literature in behavioral economics of education, where people study why individuals make these seemingly irrational choices, or at least choices that individuals tend to regret later on. And I think mentoring here is an important part of that literature, yeah? So helping individuals to master important educational transitions in forms of just giving them information or advice, yeah? So when people say later on they didn't see any point of going on, maybe just information provision might help. Providing them with role models, helping them to overcome self-control problems, and so on. Okay, so in this project, we ask, does a relatively low-cost weekly mentoring program, so it's a program where elementary school children meet with a mentor once a week for the duration of about 1 year. Does that affect the secondary school track choice in Germany? So does it affect their probability to attend a certain track after grade 4? And there are three tracks in Germany, so-called the highest track. So I will now just talk about high track, middle track, and low track. This is what they are called. Most people now go to the high track. And these don't add up to 100% because there's also a comprehensive school track where people can get all kinds of degrees, at least in this part of the country where the program took place. And tracking, I think, is interesting because it's one of the reasons for why people think mobility is so low in Germany. That children, they just have very few opportunities to catch up between grade 1 and grade 4. If they have lower skills or lower language skills, if they have received less investments at home, it's very hard for them to catch up at school up to grade 4. And then because the track choice is quite predictive of education outcomes later on, that can be detrimental in terms of intergenerational mobility. And mobility is very low in Germany. Yeah, so this is something you can see here. So the probability of a child to get a degree from the highest school track is substantially larger if the parent also has a degree from the highest school track than if the parent has a degree from the lowest school track. Yeah?
Mm-hmm. I was just wondering about the earlier numbers that you presented. Regarding the track choices, do these actually stay constant or do they change in the sense that it seemed very high, the number of people attending the highest track seemed very high. Does that actually change over the course of?
Yeah. It has, there are also studies on that, and it has increased substantially. And the fraction of individuals going to the lowest track has decreased substantially. Yeah, so there was, norms are changing here too, so.
But I mean, in the sense that after the fifth grade or sixth grade, how does it look then? I would expect that the number would go down then of people attending the highest tracks.
Say that again.
I would expect the number of people attending the highest track would decrease after a while if you would look at sixth grade or seventh grade if you would measure.
Oh, because they move to the other tracks?
Yeah, because they would drop out and then move to the lower one.
Yeah, actually not so much in grade 6 and grade 7, but there's another paper, I think, by Dustmann and co-authors. And they show that there is still quite some mobility, especially after grade 10. So it's quite some moving around across. So it's not completely decisive which track you're sent to in terms of what educational degree you will get in the end. What's super interesting is that if you just look at what predicts track choice in Germany, is that parental background, so whether children come from a poor household or a low educated household or a single parent household, still matters for the probability to be sent to the highest track, even after controlling for things like IQ or the grade point average. And that seems quite unfair, right? I mean, even if the children have the same abilities and the same grades, but come from a low socioeconomic status background, they're still less likely to make it to the highest track. And this is something, for example, where a mentoring program could be helpful. And we have some initial results, and I just, because actually this is more of a methods talk, I want to show you, well, getting like computing an overall treatment effect, if you have like really nice data as we have now, experimental variation, is really not that hard, right? So it's basically just a comparison of means. And if you do that, here on the y-axis, it's the fraction of children attending upper secondary school, so the highest track in school grade 5. And this is a high SES control group. So what you can see is that among high socioeconomic status households, more than 80% of the kids there, they are being sent to the highest track. It's also the schools that get the most resources, the teachers have the best training. So maybe high SES parents, they know that, that they send their kid to the best track, to the highest track. Among the low SES control group, it's less than 50%. Yeah, so there's like a 30 percentage point difference between low SES, the low SES control group, and the high SES control group. What's super interesting is that the mentoring program really closes an important part of that gap. Yeah, so almost one third of the gap. Good, then you can look at heterogeneity, similar effects for males and females. Interestingly, much larger effects for high poverty households than for low poverty households. And that's also quite easy, right? You just stratify the sample along whatever dimension you're interested in. What's a bit harder is if we want to know something about the mechanisms. Of course, we can write something like a structural model, as we have seen this morning. So that I guess, would be one possibility. Otherwise, yeah, say you have these nice results from a randomized controlled trial, and now you want to know why you're finding these results, right? Do the parents have different, do they view their children differently, or do they have higher skills maybe because the mentor is really smart and talked a lot to them? Or is it because whatever the teacher now thinks the child is just better behaved and gives a better recommendation? Yeah, you want to know kind of why things are working if they're working. And that would be really helpful because then we could know it or speculate a little bit better about external validity or appropriate policies. Maybe it would also help us to write like a theoretical framework or a theoretical model. So ideally, one would maybe want to separate this overall treatment effect into whatever works through observed mechanisms from other things that we maybe don't observe, such so-called unobserved residual effect. And in the econometrics literature, this is sometimes called the indirect output effect, and this is called the direct output effect. Yeah? So this is stuff that works through other things. And we may want to quantify how much of the overall effect works through which channel. And this is whatever we do not observe. So it's like the residual treatment effect. Okay, so if you look at that, yeah, so we have a treatment here, we have an outcome here. We can very nicely identify this overall effect here. But then we will want to know how much of this overall effect can be explained through some kind of observed mediating variables. such as how the parent views the child, how the child is doing, the IQ score, whatever, then it's not so hard to learn something about this relationship, right? Because we have an exogenously assigned treatment, so we can just check what's the treatment effect on whatever observed mediators we're interested in. What's really hard is, I think, what's the effect of the observed mediators on the outcome? Because this is not experimentally varied. Yeah, so we still have, and maybe we don't observe all of them. Maybe there are other things, other mediators that have also been changed through the treatment and that are correlated with the observed mediators and that also affect the outcome. Yeah, so for the first thing, it's easy. So for example, in the bond intervention panel, we see that there is an effect on child IQ in the second wave, and then there's a bit of a fading out in the third wave. We also see that there is a positive effect on locus of control, for example, of the children, which I think is kind of cool. When you ask the parents, what's the probability that your child will succeed in the highest track? We find quite some positive treatment effects here as well. Yeah, so that's for this part. This part can be much harder, and I think there's also very interesting literature that I recommend you to look at more recently. Some of that's going back to Judea Pearl. I don't know if you know who that is. It's a statistician. He's done this book on causal graphs that I think are very nice and instructive to look at. There's also a researcher, I think he's called Imai. He's a statistician at Princeton, I think, and he worked a lot on mediation analysis. He has several papers on that. There's a nice summary in Econometric Reviews by Heckman and Rodrigo Pinto. And I think there's also another nice paper, which I really like, but it's just a working paper on the non-parametric identification of these indirect effects, indirect output effects. And I don't really... and so I think there are two distinctions you can make, and I'm almost done with the talk. So there are two scenarios you can think of. Either this is observed, I copied this from a paper, but this is observed mediators, and this is unobserved mediators. If those guys here, they're not correlated, we're totally fine. Yeah, we can make some kind of matching assumption and do some kind of, for example, Oaxaca blind dot type decomposition. And we're totally fine, and we can also quantify the amount of the effect that goes through the different channels. If these guys here are correlated, it's a lot more difficult. And I think the only way to do that, if you're not doing like a full structural model, is if you have some kind of instrument that shifts the observed mechanisms but does not affect the unobserved mechanisms. And you could do that, for example, by writing a structural or a simultaneous equation model for where you have an instrument that affects the treatment and other instruments that affect the mediators. And that would then allow us to separate the residual treatment effect from whatever works through the mechanisms, namely the part of the treatment here on the mechanisms times the effect of the mechanisms on the outcome. Yeah, giving us then the effect that works through a change in mediators or mechanisms. Yeah, so I think there's lots of scope of future research, and it's a very exciting field of research, and I hope it's useful for you that I gave you my 2 cents on that, and I very much encourage you to work on that. I'm very happy that I can do this really important type of work, and I think it's great stuff. So, good luck.